بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, may the best of peace and blessings be on our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household and companions and followers until the day of judgment. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I greet you with the greeting of Islam and welcome to a new episode with a new Sahabi, one of the real stars. We are talking about the real stars for us to follow and try to implement their guidelines in our life. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam directly taught them. They saw him. They saw how he dealt with everybody around him. They implemented his guidelines in life. They read Quran, they received Quran, they learned Quran, and they implemented Quran, and they transmitted to the next generations. And here we are looking at their lives and learning from them. Today, we would live with another Sahabi companion who was very special when it comes to Quran. This is Abdullah ibn Abbas. Abdullah ibn Abbas is the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the son of Al-Abbas. Al-Abbas is the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was known to be Habrul Ummah, the well-versed scholar of this Ummah, of this nation, and Tarjuman al-Quran, the translator of the Quran. He was so special when it comes to Quran, so special when it comes to knowledge. He learned from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at very young age, even though he was so young when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. He was born 3 years before the Hijrah, and he was so young when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. Yet he has learned a lot from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for him. He said, Allahumma faqihhu fi ddeen, O Allah, give him the fiqh, the understanding of this religion, wa'allimhu ta'wil, and give him the interpretation or the understanding of the deen and the Quran. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was so smart as well. He has the wisdom. And Umar radiallahu anhu used to admire him very much, and used to, when he was Khalifa, he would count on Abdullah ibn Abbas, and he would even consult with him, and he would bring him closer to him with the elite, with the elders, the elderly scholars and Sahaba, and the people that he would usually consult with. He would make Abdullah ibn Abbas one of them. That sometimes even some of the Sahaba would say, this is so young of a person, you know, they wonder, this is so young to bring him with those, you know, people that your counselors or people that you consult with and so on. But Umar radiallahu anhu tried to prove for them that this is somebody who deserves, because he's so smart, so knowledgeable. He learned a lot from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that sometimes he would ask them a question and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is there listening. And then he would get the answer from them. He would get the answer from Abdullah ibn Abbas. And Abdullah ibn Abbas would usually give the right answer for them. Like one day he would ask him, what do you think about Laylatul Qadr? We know it's in the last 10 nights, but which night exactly? Some would say in the night, the 29th, the 21st, the 25th, 23rd. But Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, you're asking me my opinion, I'm going to say my opinion. I see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in many verses of the Quran is talking about the number 7. Samawat, the skies are 7, the earth are 7, and he was referring to the 27th as being Laylatul Qadr. In other question, other time, Umar radiallahu anhu asked about the meaning of وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ, which is an announcement for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or order for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from Allah, that when you see people coming in droves into the religion, this is the time you make tasbih to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and forgiveness, ask forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Umar radiallahu anhu asked the question, what could this mean? And everybody would say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling his Prophet that when you see people coming into religion in droves, you thank Allah, you make tasbih, and you ask istighfar. What do you think, Abdullah ibn Abbas? Abdullah ibn Abbas would give a different answer. He said, this is a reference to the end of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was marking the end. If everybody is coming to Islam and Islam is spreading everywhere, you get to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this and seek forgiveness, because it is the your ajal, or your time is coming very soon. And that was the right answer from Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. He learned directly from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One day Al-Abbas, his father, sent him to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and spend the night with him because Maymuna radiallahu anha was very close to Abdullah ibn Abbas. She was his aunt, and he spent the night in there in the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam just to see how would he pray at night. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he described for us that he went, he slept, he said, until I heard the noise of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sleeping. He slept, deeply slept for quite a while. And then he woke up and he made tasbih to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, Subhan al-Malik al-Quddus, glorified is the king who is far above anything that's not fit for him. And then he said that three times, and he recited the ayah from Surah Ali Imran. إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَاتٍ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا سُبْحَانَكَ فَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. The Prophet ﷺ would recite these ayat, or this ayah from the end towards the end of Surah Ali Imran, which is talking about those who reflect. Indeed, there are miracles and there are ayat and signs in the creation of the skies and in the creation of the earth and the alternation of the day and night. There are many signs for those who reflect and those who think and those who reflect and think. Those who mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while standing, while sitting, while being on their sides, and they reflect on the creation of the skies, and they reflect on the creation of the earth, and they would say, oh, our Lord, you have not created all of that in vain. Glorified are you. Protect us from the torment or the punishment of the fire of hell. So you reflect on the creation. Subhanallah. Nowadays, we see some people are going left and right. How did the creation begin? There is the Big Bang. There is this. There is the evolution. We all come from one cell. It came by accident. And subhanAllah, there's nothing of that that we see in observation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, how did it begin? And how could it make sense for anybody, for all of this marvelous creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even in one cell, not in the whole creation, how could it just come from nothing? How could it come from one cell by accident that all of what we see with our eyes is just coming and forming and coming together by accident and evolving like that? So the Quran is talking about that. Reflect and think, how would all of that happen? How the skies are happening, how the wind is moving, how the rain is coming. This is what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would read as a reminder and reflection for himself before he would start connecting with the creator of all of that. Because if you reflect unbiased, away from all the external, you know, biased ideas and views, you will truly find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you find Him, you will love to connect with Him as if this is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is what he is doing and what he is telling us to do. He would connect with Allah. He would stand up praying two rak'ah first, and then he will continue praying at night. That's what Abdullah ibn Abbas is describing for us. And then at the end, he would say the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would make the prayer, the du'a, Allahumma ja'al fi sam'i nura, fi basari nura, O Allah, give me light in my eyes, give me light in my ears, make light in my heart, make light on my right side and left side and above me and under me and front of me. Give me light. If we are giving light, we will make the right decisions. We will see with the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَجْعَلِ اللَّهُ لَهُ نُورًا فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ نُورٍ. If somebody is prevented from the light of Allah, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevented his light from somebody, there's going to be no light for that person to go with. So, oh Allah, give us your light, Ya Rabbil Alameen. The Prophet ﷺ is making this dua at night, and Abdullah ibn Abbas is transferring this to us. Abdullah ibn Abbas was also utilized by Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu because he was so smart. He had the power of argument. He's so smart. Those Khawarij separatists and Kharijites who decided to abandon the camp of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, and they had so many. They were very extreme in their views, even though they prayed and read Quran, and some of them were scholars and everything. He sent Abdullah ibn Abbas for them to argue with them, to talk to them. He said, what do you think? Why are you disagreeing with Ali radiallahu anhu, and they said, well, he started accepting arbitrators of people. How could we have judges on, you know, in the Book of Allah from people like that, when the Book of Allah Azza wa Jalla itself is there? And Ali radiallahu anhu, he accepted when they said, you are not the Amir al-Mu'mineen, you are not the commander of the believers. He said, it's okay. And he started talking to them like that. And they give so many other things. He said, well, if Ali radiallahu anhu was talking to them and they did not accept him as Amir al-Mu'mineen, and he accepted that just for the sake of argument, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before him in the Battle of Al-Hudaybiyah, as he was talking to the people of Quraysh, and he said, هَذَا مَا قَاضَ عَلَيْهِ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, this is what the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad, agreed on with Quraysh. And they said, hold on, we do not know that you are the Messenger of Allah. We know you are Muhammad. We do not accept that you are the Messenger of Allah. And he accepted that, and he removed the Messenger of Allah. Ali radiallahu anhu did the same thing. There's no point in here. And if you are saying that he is asking some people to judge, to be judged and arbitrators between the two camps, Allah said in the Quran, يَحْكُمُ بِهِ ذَوَ عَدْلٍ مِّنْكُمْ, which is talking about hunting. If somebody hunted, if somebody hunts during ihram, state of ihram, Allah said then you should appoint two arbitrators who would make an assessment. How big is this animal? Is it like a cow? Is it like a camel? Is it like a goat? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would ask us to make arbitration and have arbitrators to make decision and judges to make decision, when it comes to something very trivial like somebody who hunts during the ihram, why not we appoint arbitrators when it comes to the blood of Muslims, shedding of a blood and disagreement that will lead to war? And he kept going on and on with this beautiful kind of analogy with those Kharijites. And many of them, actually thousands of them in some narration, 20,000 of them decided to give up on their views and come back to the right way and right course because of the light of Allah and the knowledge and the smartness and intelligence of Abdullah ibn Abbas. He lived his life with Quran, and for the Quran, he lived his life learning from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then from Abu Bakr and Umar, and then he taught everybody who came later on. He had, during the later period of his time, he had his classes. He would teach every day in the week. One day he would teach Quran, one day he would teach Hadith, and so on. He was a university in himself that graduated in this university. So many generations graduated on Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiyallahu anhu wa ardahu. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him. May Allah put us with Abdullah ibn Abbas and the rest of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Al-Jannah along with you. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. Until I see you next time, I leave you in the care of Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.